So let's see what Holy Spirit says. What is our glory? Answer. Awareness of self may seem to be a glorious achievement, but it is a humble awareness of the glory that is. It is that glory which you share with your brother. It may seem to be achieved by some and not by others, but it is always present. When you celebrate your brother's glory and your own glory, you invite it to spring forth into your awareness. It comes as it is invited because it is always there to be seen as you choose to see it. Your invitation to it is your choice to see it. Your celebration of it is your choice to love it, share it, and be it. So again, what Holy Spirit is telling us then is it's not enlightenment that is our glory, which probably at this time I would have thought that. I would have thought to be enlightened is glory, and to not be enlightened is not glory. And Holy Spirit is saying that is not true. Our glory is what we are. And what we are whether we are aware of it or not. So whether we seem to be enlightened or not. And he's saying that as I celebrate that truth, within my brother, within me, whether the awareness is there or not, what I'm really doing is inviting that awareness into my mind. So even though I don't yet have that awareness, by celebrating just through trust, celebrating just through trust that the truth is true and that we are this glorious, magnificent Son of God, by celebrating that, I will come to know that. This is really just another way of expressing giving willingness. It's another way of expressing nursing our willingness to allow it to grow to full will. So I said to the Holy Spirit, I see. So we make the mistake of confusing specialness with glory, and they aren't the same thing at all. Because what I was realizing at this point was when I looked at people that I thought of as enlightened, I saw them as special. I saw them as being glorious or having glory. And the rest of us who were not enlightened, I did not put in the same category. So I was really beginning to recognize this error in my mind that I thought some were special, some were not. Some had glory, some did not. And Holy Spirit, of course, is telling me that we all have the glory all of the time. So Holy Spirit continues, your glory is shared and your glory is now. There is nothing to achieve. To achieve is to separate, because some may seem to achieve and others may not. One does not achieve enlightenment. One realizes what is. Glory is. Glory is now. Celebrate it now. So notice how he's completely erasing any lines that may seem to divide us on the spiritual path. I mean, he is saying that, you know, I am no different from some person who may seem to be fully enlightened now, and I am also no different than my, you know, biological brother Roger, who has absolutely no interest in spirituality, and there is no difference between my biological brother Roger and some enlightened master that may be on the earth now, that we all have that same glory right now. Right now. And for me at this time, this was a completely new thought, because I would have separated the three. I would have thought the enlightened one was the most glorious, that me being on the spiritual path was the second glorious, and my brother not even caring about spirituality was the least glorious. So I would have separated us. And Holy Spirit is totally correcting that error in my mind. We are all the same. We are all glorious because we all are what we are in truth right now. Whether we realize it or not is totally, totally irrelevant. We are what we are right now. There's nothing to achieve. So I asked the Holy Spirit, what else would you share with me on this topic? Answer, your prayers are an invitation to see your glory. Keep praying your prayers and make them a part of your ongoing thought process. So again, he's teaching me to nurse that willingness to become aware of what is. Put aside thoughts about the world and what there is to be done. Trust me to guide you in your doing. I can still use help with this. I noticed when Laurent was here, Laurent is magnificent, and I'll tell you why he's magnificent. He's magnificent because he never quits thinking about God. Never. Never, ever, ever. He has always got God on his mind. He is always mind watching. He is always doing the work. And what he would want to do when he was here, which was perfectly correct, is he would want to have these long conversations about God, long conversations about our messages, long conversations about things that were in his mind that he wanted to look at. And sometimes I wanted to do the dishes or mow the lawn or, you know, clean the house, or, you know, answer your emails or make CDs that someone had ordered, you know, or do some work for the Be the Love conference planning. I felt like I had all of these things piling up on me to do. And at times it led to a lot of frustration for me. And so this is one thing I had to keep teaching myself over and over while Arant was here. I had to keep allowing the current moment to be exactly as it was and not wish for it to be different, not wish for me to be someplace else, doing something else, getting something done. I needed to allow the current moment to be exactly as it was, trust that the Holy Spirit had me exactly where he wanted me to be, and that anything that was not getting done was okay. And I really had to focus on this. I had to use the rat technique, the rest, accept, and trust, with the fact that, with the idea that things were not getting done. Rest, accept, and trust, and allow myself to be in all of these conversations with Laurent, which was the perfect thing for me to do because it was all of these conversations that led to all of these profound messages. If I had been overly concerned about keeping the house clean, doing the dishes, cooking dinners, all of that, we would not have had those messages. So still something that I had to work on because I like to have things done. And still something I need to continue to watch my mind on. So Holy Spirit says, put aside thoughts about the world and what there is to be done. You hear that? Hear that, Regina? I'm going to read this to Regina again. You all, please be patient with your sister. Trust me to guide you in your doing. Put aside thoughts about the world and what there is to be done. Trust me to guide you in your doing. Let go of trusting yourself and trust me. Listen, this is what Laurent does. This is why Laurent is so perfect, and this is why he was so perfect of an influence on me. Use your mind to pray, to celebrate, and to invite the awareness of glory. Make ready for your awareness by preparing your mind to welcome it. Make space for it. Prepare a place of honor for it in your mind with nothing in the way to cloud its light. This is exactly what I admired, still admire about him, is how his mind is always, always, always focused on God. You know, to an observer, it may seem like he's not doing other things that he could be doing. You know, that he could be doing something else other than just talking about God all day. But as we can see, truly, you know, he's in the right place. And in fact, it's reminding me of a story I read in a book about Jesus's life. I don't remember the name of the book. It may have been Jesus and the Mastership, may have been the name of the book, if that is a book. But I read part of a book once about Jesus's life. And in that book, there was a story about when Jesus was visiting his friends in Bethany, Lazarus and his two sisters, Mary and Martha. And I don't remember which sister was which. I think that Mary was the one that was sitting with Jesus and Lazarus and discussing God. And Martha was the one that was concerned about getting the dinner cooked, keeping the house clean. And Martha, as Mary just sat at Jesus' feet discussing God with Jesus and Lazarus, Martha became increasingly annoyed with Mary because Mary was not helping her do the things that needed to get done, not helping her with the house, not helping her cook the meal. And as Martha became increasingly annoyed, she continued to do the work, and finally she got the dinner ready, and then Jesus, Mary, and Lazarus didn't get up and come eat it. They kept right on talking about God after Martha had put all this effort all by herself into preparing this meal. And she was getting increasingly annoyed, and finally when she, you know, erupted a little bit, Jesus explained to her that Mary was the one that was in the right. Mary was the one that was in the right, sitting and discussing God and letting everything else go. You know, that was the proper place to be. And so this was something, again, that I learned with Laurent, because all he wanted to do is talk about God. He didn't care at all if anything else got done. And so it was really helpful to have him around. And so, I noticed Mary Ellen saying she needs to hear this too. I'm sure many of us do. But really, if we want to accept the atonement to ourselves, all we need to do is keep our mind focused on God and then let Holy Spirit guide our doing. That which needs to be done will get done. And that which isn't getting done in the moment doesn't need to be done then. And we need to really, really trust this. So again, I'm going to read this one more time. Your prayers are an invitation to see your glory. Keep praying your prayers and make them a part of your ongoing thought process. Put aside thoughts about the world and what there is to be done. Trust me to guide you in your doing. Let go of trusting yourself and trust me. Use your mind to pray, to celebrate, and to invite the awareness of glory. Make ready for your awareness by preparing your mind to welcome it. Make space for it. Prepare a place of honor for it in your mind with nothing in the way to cloud its light. And of course, worrying about whether the lawn is getting mowed or whether the dinner is getting cooked or whether the dishes are getting done, that's having something in the way to cloud the light. So Holy Spirit is asking us to let go of all of that, have our mind only focused on God, and then any doing that needs to be done will simply be guided. This is the process of accepting the answer, which I have told you is your only responsibility. Now listen to this. This is so perfect. Yet you think you have many responsibilities, right? You think you have to do the dishes. You think you have to mow the lawn. You think you have to clean the bathroom. You think you have to cook the dinner. You think you have to pay the bills. You think you have to answer the emails. You think you have to plan a conference for, 8808. You know, you think you have many responsibilities, but I've told you you have only one. You know, that's what he's saying. I've told you you have only one. This is the process of accepting the answer, which I have told you is your only responsibility. Yet you think you have many responsibilities. How can you have many responsibilities and have only one? One of these thoughts must be a mistake, right? You either have many responsibilities or you have only one, but they can't both be true. One of these thoughts must be a mistake. Are you willing to accept in faith that you have only one responsibility, and that is to make ready to welcome the aware? And it looks like this got cut off. I'm going to assume this probably said the awareness of your glory.